Hello all! Today we're going to take a look at this AdGames Arcade Gamer Portable. This is a handheld console made by Ingo Devices for AdGames. It's basically a master system or Game Gear on a chip, and it has a couple of Sega licensed games from both the master system and the Game Gear. So now let's open it up and take a look at what's inside, and after that I show you some games and comparisons with real hardware and see if it's worth getting it if you find it second hand on a flea market or something like that. Here's the battle case. It uses three AAA batteries. And then there are four more screws. Now to pry it open, it has some clips, so I'm going to use an iPhone opening tool to help with the clips. Size open. This side is open as well, and no, it's completely open. Now we can see the contents. Oh, one of the batteries is running away. We can see all the components here. So this is the connector to the display that's behind here. This is the power switch. This is the CPU, so it's completely in a blob, so we cannot see what it is. And this is the flash memory. It's DMC D30N1608 2T024500. That's the flash chip that contains the integrated games and possibly an operating system or anything. And here the AV out or video out also gets audio output, and the headphone jack for sound only. So there's not much to it. now let's try it with some games to see what games it has. I know some other pages say that it has an SD card slot for putting more games, but this model doesn't have any place on the motherboard to even have one as an option at all. So there's no way to go beyond the games that are already included. Now, on the list of games, we have another advantage of ad games compared to other manufacturers of this kind of consoles, and is that the menu doesn't have any kind of background music. Thankfully, it only emits a beep when we move to change the selection. It's divided in 4 pages and contains a total of 30 games. 20 of those games are Master System games or Sega Mark III, while 10 of those games are Game Gear games. I will show in the description a list of all of them. Quiet Games has decided to include the Game Gear version of some games that have a Master System version is unknown to me. It may be just something about licensing or some other reason, because technically there's no problem running them, and we must consider that the Game Gear games output on a resolution on 160x144, while the Master System counterparts use a resolution of 256px by 240px, almost double of that. In any case, the output using the TV cable from this console is always 2880p or 240p using the pulse signal at 50Hz. For the American users, this will make the game sound strange, but for European users, it will just be the way it sounded on our childhoods. Let's talk about the games, probably the reason why you're here in the first place. Checking the critic reviews on Moby Games, I have made an aggregate or the score with just the average of all of them. Now, I consider a good game if this average score is 75 over a scale of 100. A mediocre game is it's below 75 but above 50, and a bad game if it's below 50. In this console, of the 30 games, 15 meet this criteria for good games. They have a score over 75. 13 of them are just mediocre, and 2 of them are just criminally bad. Their score is even lower than 40 in a scale of 100. As with all critic reviews, they don't always tend to be hand on hand with what people think about, so I'm just going to give my very personal and subjective opinion on some of these games. In the case of Alex Kidd in Miracle War, that has an aggregated score of 86, is an amazing game. I have always considered it an amazing game. It was included with the second revision of the Master System, at least in Europe, and it's good to have it included here. Now, we also have Columns and Super Columns, and yeah, okay, they're good, they're the typical puzzle game that came after Tetris, but I never got a liking for that. It's just, yeah, it feels like Sega was trying to copy Tetris. It's just what it feels. It's good, you can have a nice time playing it, but it's not something I would recommend. What I will recommend is the Fantasy Zone, as well as the second part, Fantasy Zone Opa Opa. And I think that it's a very colorful game, amazing music, sound effects, and very fun to play, even if that difficult. Other games are here just to take space on the flash, including the console, like for example Baku Baku Animal and Bim Bim Machine. I mean, we already have 2 columns, we don't need yet another puzzle of the same kind, that's just a different intellectual property or just using the Sony intellectual property. These 2 games make nothing in this console. Some of my favorite games here, for example, are Penguin Land. I love that game, really. When I saw what game it was, because I didn't recognize the name, I said it, I love this game, and it's a game I will revisit. But I would prefer to revisit it on a proper Master System instead of on a handheld console. Still, it's a game I will certainly play on this machine. Another of my favorites that is in this console is Golden Axe, but this game deserves to be played on the arcade version, and we're limited to the Master System version here. One game that has an aggregated score of 76 over 100, meaning it's supposedly a good game, but I don't think they deserve that score, is Sonic Drift 2. It's completely unmanageable, unplayable in my opinion. I don't understand why the critics did this review on the Game Gear version if it worked like this. Another unplayable game that should have never been made is Sonic Spinball. It's slow, The frame rate is awful, and again, completely unplayable. For the looks of it, it would have worked the same on the Game Gear. They should have just not done this game at all. So it's not the fault of this console, it's the fault of the game itself. A special mention to make about unplayable games in this console is Assault City. It's a game that clearly looks like it only would work with the light gun, and if you check for the Master System, there were two versions, one to use with the control D-pad and another with the light gun. This is obviously the control D-pad version, and it's completely unplayable. It makes no sense, you cannot move the D-pad fast enough to kill the enemies, and yeah, with a light gun, this game on a TV would be fun. Hitting the console using the D-pad on a real Master System or Sega Mark III using D-pad, it would be unplayable and it's not funny at all. Contrary to what the critics say, there are two games that are seen that are more than mediocre, they are good games. They are Dragon Crystal and Kung Fu Kid. Kung Fu Kid in particular, I say in the streaming, I find it practically the perfect game. It has good graphics, big sprites, and it's fun. The concept is yes, you are a kid that does kung fu kicks and hits and punches to kill the enemies, and it's a platform with this kind of objective or way of killing the enemies, and I found it very fun. I would play it again. However, the critics give them a score less than 75 in a scale of 100, and personally, I think they're completely wrong. You should try this game, Kung Fu Kid, remember it. There are two games where I agree with the critics, they are amazing games. One of them is Sonic Chaos, that we'll talk later in the video, just showing the comparison of some with Real Machines emulator and the Master System version, and Ristar. Ristar looks like some kind of platforming exclusive for the Game Gear, and I think it looks very funny. I will play it more and know more about that game, probably will make a video only about that game, because it looks pretty funny. And the final game I want to talk about is Snail Maze. It's a criminally bad game, but this fun is included here. I didn't know when I tried it, I was surprised on the streaming, but after looking at it, it seems that it's an Easter egg on the Mark III or the first model of the Master System BIOS, with a key combination. When you see the Sega logo, you enter this game instead of nothing or the game you had on the cartridge, and that's supposed that's why it's here, but really it's a bad game, it's an awful game. So let's just say it's here because of the Easter egg. Maybe you've never known it and you never saw this game because of not knowing the Easter egg. On those times there was no internet or Google or forums to check for that. So let's say it has its place here. The first thing we're going to take a look is at the quality of the composite output, the TV output. Let's zoom on it here on Sonic Chaos. We can see now that there's not much trembling. It looks relatively okay considering its composite output. As I said before, the output is 2880p or 240p at 50Hz using a pulse signal. If we look at the integrated screen, we can see that it has a crisper image than the composite output, indicating us that it's getting the image directly from the graphics processor. However, this screen has very washed colors, light bleeding on all of the corners, and a lot of ghosting. It's not very fit for the purpose of a handheld, and it's something that you will not want to look at for many hours straight, but it's usable as long as you're on low light conditions. Under direct sunlight or high light conditions, it becomes completely impossible to see. Let's talk about the graphics. Here we have four screens. On the left, we have both outputs from this Ad Games console. On the up left, we have the screen as it is, captured with a phone camera. On the bottom left, we have the composite output, and on the right, we have the McNuffin emulator. On the top right, we have the Master System version of the game, and on the bottom right, we have the Game Gear version of the game. We can see here that on neither of the outputs of this Ad Games console, the aspect ratio is not respected. It's not the Master System aspect ratio, and it's not the Game Gear aspect ratio, even if the Game Gear game is the one that's running. Also, if you look on the left, you can see that the composite output is like going slower, it's drifting slowly over time, while the screen itself is not. It's more on sync with the emulator. However, the music is running synchronized in all the four games. It's very strange. I checked the capture devices, my capture system, and it's not happening with other systems. It's only happening with this one, and I find it very, very strange. Let's listen now to the audio from the TV output. Now let's listen to the audio from the integrated speaker output. Now let's listen to the audio from the MNAFEN emulator. As you can see, the emulator and the TV output get very similar audio. However, the internal speaker sounds like it's accelerated. I experienced the same on person and I'm puzzled as why the video output from the composite output is slower, drifting to be more slow over time, while the audio from the internal speaking is drifting to be much faster over time. I don't understand why. It's not something that you really realize unless you're doing a comparison. It's still very playable. Finally, I will compare the audio from the TV output with the audio generated by a Sega Mega Drive, because I do not have a working in gear to try it. This is the audio from the Mega Drive. And this is the audio from the At Games unit. We can see that there is a slight difference, especially in the higher frequencies, but it's not very appreciable again unless you are doing a comparison. It still keeps being very playable, but as checking with the internal speaker, it all depends that you have headphones, because the speaker itself is very bad quality. So finally, as a conclusion, would I recommend you getting this unit if you find it second hand on a flea market, a boot market or something like that? I think yes. I think it's a good collectible to have. All games are licensed, some of them are very good, some of them are just mediocre, but it's a good thing to have in your collection. So if you find it cheap, like 10-15 euros, go for it, don't take a dab and buy it. I hope that you liked this video, thanks for watching, and please don't forget to subscribe and click the bell. If you want me to continue doing these videos as well as open source software for preservation, please subscribe to my Patreon as well. See you in the next video. Bye.